Bonjour à toutes et à tous et bienvenue sur Cannes Série Live, la plateforme digitale de Cannes Série saison 3, disponible du 9 au 14 octobre en ligne, mais aussi à Cannes. So dear Carl, it is a great honor and true privilege to welcome you today at Cannes Série Festival. Thank you so much for joining us. Even though we are a TV series festival, I'd like to start with the beginning of your movie career. So your acting career starts in the year 10,191, if I remember well, on planet Arrakis. You
good.
Are called Atreides in Dune, David Lynch's 1984 science fiction movie. This was your very first assignment, moreover in a highly anticipated movie. How was this beginning for you?
Well, thank you, Claire, and thank you for having me here. It's a great honor to be able to speak with you and to talk through this career that has gotten longer, thankfully, surprisingly. I think when I started, I really had no idea of where I was going to end up. Not that it's finished. It's still ongoing. But it's great to be able to speak about a few things that I've done over the years. Some things I'm proud of, some things perhaps less so, but here I am. So Dune was indeed my first film. There were many firsts, actually. It was my first time in front of a camera. It was my first time working with David Lynch, a relationship that I cherish and adore. That man means so much to me. And it was the first time I got to work with Sting. So there you go. There's three firsts right there off the bat. I auditioned in Seattle on tape, which was then shown to David Lynch and Rafaela De Laurentiis, who were in Los Angeles, and they flew me down. We met. David and I had a lovely conversation, and he invited me back to screen test for the role of Paul. Now, it was a book that I knew extremely well. I'd read the book a few times a year since I was 15, so I knew it forwards and backwards, as the saying goes. So bringing all of that knowledge into the screen test was extremely helpful. In fact, I remember speaking with Patrick Stewart, who played Gurney Halleck, when he was asking me, what is this and what is that? And I was kind of the encyclopedia for the inner workings of the book for all of my castmates. So I was able to help them out. It was an experience unlike anything I'd ever had before. We shot in Mexico City for 7 months. I made some great friendships down there. It was like something going on to a different planet in a way, for me. And it was, it transformed my career from being what I was expecting, which was a repertory theater actor, into including film and television into my resume.
Is it true you got a phone call from a casting agent and at first you thought like somebody was playing a prank on you?
Well, yes, kind of. I got a phone call in my apartment in Seattle. I was still living near the campus of the University of Washington. It was a little tiny single studio apartment. And that was back in the day when we had answering machines that had cassette tapes on them and you had to rewind and listen, and someone had called and said something about Paul and Dune and auditioning for a movie, and I was like, this is so strange. someone must be making fun of me somehow, that they would be making a movie of Dune and that they would be thinking of me for the role of Paul. It's somebody who knows me very well and knows what a fan I was of the books. And I'm sure they were pranking me. And then I dug a little deeper and realized, no, there was a casting agent coming to Seattle with the intention of meeting young actors to see if someone could fill the shoes of Paul Atreides.
Of Paul Atreides.
Yeah.
There's a planet. I will kill you. The second moon.
Tell me of your homeworld, Usul.
The amazing thing with this character is that David Lynch turned you into this sort of very innocent young man, a million miles away from the regular action hero of the 80s, which was quite unusual at the time, right?
Well, it was. And you're right, the 80s was kind of an action hero time. I don't think that genre ever really goes out of fashion, but it was very, very much present at that time. We both, David and I, you know, taking our cue from the book, recognize that there's a transition that happens in the character. And he goes from young, untested, well-trained, but lacking any real battle experience or leadership experience, and throws him into a situation where he has to learn very quickly. So the goal, I think, or what maybe perhaps what David was looking for in casting the role was someone who could both be believable as sort of the young, innocent Paul when you first see him, and then there would need to be a transformation because the film jumps ahead a few years to see that he actually is, I wouldn't say battle-hardened necessarily, but certainly capable of leading men into a situation of danger like that. And we needed to see that transition. And he felt that I, as an actor, was capable of doing that, which was, you know, it was really an honor for him to consider that I could do that. Certainly just being fresh out of school and never having been in front of a film or television camera in my life. And yet he had the confidence in me to be able to pull that off.
So the book by Frank Herbert is, the novel is a personal quest. I was wondering, so for you as an actor, was it a sort of initiatory quest as well?
It was a quest that the book, of course, meant a great deal to me. And I was 15 when I read it for the first time, very impressionable. And I think like most people who read that book at that age, you put yourself in as the character of Paul. You believe that you are this character. You react as you think the character would react. I would carry some of the sensibility of the book, let's say, into my life. And I would say, you know, what would Paul do in this situation? How would he be able to endure this, et cetera? So, you know, very fantastical thinking. And during the filming, definitely transformative. First of all, just exposure to all the different actors and the different cultures that they came from. We had English actors, Italian actors, certainly American actors, German actors. I mean, we had people from all over, Max von Sydow. So we had a real mix of people, and they all brought their culture with them because we were together for such a long period of time, 7 months filming in Mexico City, and everyone had houses. So on any given night, we were all together over at, let's say, Rafaela's house, having a big Italian meal cooked by her mom, Silvana Mangano, who was, you know, I mean, she was also in the film and an extraordinary actress, in her, you know, from Italian cinema. And these kind of things were just kind of normal. And so for a young man originally from Yakima, Washington, having gone to school in Seattle, my world was quite small. So suddenly it expanded in this way that was completely unexpected.
You mentioned before that you trained as an actor at the University of Washington, your home state. Why did you choose this path in the first place? Because, I mean, your parents were not in the film industry, even though your mother was the director of a youth theater program, I guess.
Yes. Growing up, I was exposed to the theater. My mom was a big supporter of the local community theater in our small town. In fact, we lived very close to the theater, which was a converted Apple storage warehouse that had been transformed into a community theater. And we, during our summer months, would sort of help out either in, you know, doing set building or props or lighting during the show. So we were around the theater, although I don't think we thought of it as something that we were going to be involved in. My brothers and I, we were all together, the three of us. But what happened was, as I got further along and I would do a few productions and I got into high school, I recognized that I actually, having done the plays, had a certain skill. I had an ability there that was that I didn't really expect, but felt comfortable to me. It wasn't something that I took that seriously. I really enjoyed it, and I put a lot of heart and soul into it, but it wasn't something I was looking to as a career. I got to college, tried to take classes, did not fare very well. I wasn't a very good student, but I found myself drawn back to the theater and back to the drama classes. Not so much the classes, but mostly the theater and the performing. And I think I finally just gave in. I realized that this was a direction that I was supposed to go in. I always say the door kept opening. If I knocked on the door with curiosity, the door would open and I would walk in and I would be, oh, this, I feel right at home here. And then there'd be another door and I'd knock on that door and I would go into that. So it was kind of an ongoing acceptance of this, of something that I deep down really loved, but didn't really feel like it was, you know, I don't know, possible to have a career in. I didn't have a model. Like you said, my parents were not in the theater. They were supportive, certainly, but they weren't, this wasn't something that they did. So I had to kind of figure it out for myself. And I was fortunate enough at the University of Washington, there was a training program that was in place, one of 10 in the country that was specifically geared towards training an actor for repertory theater. So all day were just classes devoted to that. So you had acting class, you had movement class, you had speech, language class, you had circus class, juggling, stage fighting, meditation, and performance. And I was accepted into this program. There were 13 students in this particular school. So it was very selective. So I auditioned and was accepted.
There you are.
And here we go. And I really just kind of said, okay, I guess this is what I'm going to do for now. You know, let's see what happens.
There's a new version coming, like due out at the end of the year by a Canadian director, Denis Villeneuve. Is this something you're excited about or eager to see, or do you have mixed emotions about it?
I have many emotions about it, surprisingly. I am looking forward to seeing it. It's a book that is still my favorite. I could see 10 versions of Dune and I would be so happy. Just because I love the story so much. And so I will definitely see it. I had the occasion to watch a trailer. There's a brief trailer.
Yeah, with Timothée Chalamet.
And I found myself feeling very nostalgic. That was the overriding emotion. And I didn't expect that at all, but I was watching scenes that were very similar in tone and in dialogue, of course, and in even the way they were shot. And I was like, oh my gosh. And it brought back these floods of memories of my experience doing the scene with John Phillips, with the box and the pain and the thing. And I was like, oh my gosh, I remember that. And these emotions came flooding back in. And I was very kind of overwhelmed and very kind of moved by it. Cause I was reliving what I had done. And I didn't expect to have that reaction at all. I thought it looked great. I think they have the benefit of these years of digital capability that we didn't have. In order for us to create the illusion of the worms, they actually had to be what they call practical. So they were all models, they were miniatures, but they could all move and work. And that's very limiting, of course, in terms of what you can and cannot do. So I was really excited to see how they had digitized these gigantic creatures. And I think those were really effective in the trailer. And I also think Timothy is gonna be a terrific Paul. You know, he has the sensitivity, I think, and he has the ability to grow. It's the transition of the character, and I think he will do a wonderful job, so.
An animal caught in a trap will gnaw off its own leg to escape. What will you do?
I know you.
One day, the legend will be born. All of civilization depends on it.
The future, I can see it. I must not fear. Fear is the mind killer.
We have like a few special guests in this program, and One of our guests has a question for you, I guess, or maybe two. Let's see.
Kale, how are you doing, Kale? I thought of two questions for you that could result in stories you could tell. The first thing, first question is, how come I call you Kale? Maybe people already know that, but you could tell the story.
First of all, what a treat to see David in his workshop. He has been such a, has had such a profound impact on my career. So he asked a question about why I'm called Kale. And it actually happens during the film, during Dune, we worked together. The producer of the film was Rafaela De Laurentiis, but it was also produced by her father, Dino De Laurentiis. And Dino has a very, very strong Italian accent. So when he met me for the first time, he had a very difficult time pronouncing my name. Kyle, that is not a sound that you make in Italian. So I think his way to try to get through that was to just make it Kale. And not only was it Kale, but it was in his very particular way of speaking. So Kale, Kale. Everything was quite guttural and impactful. Well, David Lynch just loved that. And so from then on, throughout our long friendship, he has called me Kale. Now I refer to him by his initials sometimes, which are DKL, and I call him DKL. So DKL, DKL. So we have a little shorthand there between the two of us that I don't think anybody else really gets a kick out of, but we sort of enjoy it. So that's the story of Kale and DKL.
That's a great story.
Thank you.
Fantastic story. I didn't know anything about that story.
Nope, and it's all true.
So with his very first movie, Dune, you entered David Lynch's universe for good. And 2 years later, in 1986, your second movie, also directed by David Lynch, came out. In Blue Velvet, your character, Jeffrey Bauman, is another kind of candid young man torn between right and wrong. And I would like to have a look at a couple of specific scenes that I picked for this special program.
Dorothy, you gotta do something. Go to the police.
No police. No police. Don't hit me!
No! No!
Get away! Get away from my bed!
You know what a love letter is? It's a bullet from a fucking gun, fucker. You receive a love letter from me, you're fucked forever. You understand, fuck? I'll send you straight to hell, fucker.
Of course, there's the erotic tension in the movie, but there's also Dennis Hopper's very intense character, Frank. Yes. Hopper was an incredibly powerful performer, but he was also perceived as a highly subversive actor at that time. Did David Lynch use you as two sides of the same coin?
I think yes to the first question. I mean, I think that's it's good and evil. And I think it's a little bit like the yin-yang symbol where there's a touch of good in both and a touch of evil in both. And I think Dennis's performance was both powerful, overwhelming, frightening, dangerous. But there was, you also, I came away with there's, you have empathy for him and for his, where he is, I do anyway, where he's been trapped, how he's been caught. And you see this person who has been transformed. Just as in Jeffrey, you see this sort of young, callow, naive youth who has this darkness, a little bit of darkness that he recognizes could easily get out of control, easily sort of burst into flame and take over. And he fights against that as the character. So I think they definitely are two sides of the good versus evil model. Working with Dennis was a pleasure. He was an absolute professional. Everyone knows about his issues. He had been sober for a few years before he started filming Blue Velvet, absolutely in control, but had, of course, the sense memory of all the times when he was not in control. And I think he drew upon those experiences to create the role of Frank. In fact, I think David tells the story of when he met Dennis, that Dennis said, "I am Frank." I don't think in the present, but he at least knew that he could revisit that territory as an actor. He made my job very easy. All I had to do was react. Dennis, as you said, was incredibly powerful, very persuasive. And I was hostage, you know, there was nothing I could do. It made my work very easy, as did working with Isabella Rossellini, as did working with Laura Dern. There were very intimate moments, as you could see from one of the scenes there. And we were just kind of trying to treat each other with respect and have a laugh and recognizing that we're both very vulnerable in these situations. You need to have that lightness, at least I do, in order to do what the scene was requiring, which was this kind of intense violence, this bottled up violence, I always liken it to something that's been open, like Pandora's box has been open, and you try to close it back again and it's too late. I hadn't actually seen those scenes. It's been a long time. I float back to that time and I'm flooded with nostalgia and sense memory of shooting that sequence and the kind of care that David took as a director with that. He creates a very, very safe environment in order for those things to happen on set. And that's always been his one of his great skills, I think.
The movie is obviously very intense, but apparently you had great fun filming it.
We kind of bonded together. We were shooting in a little town of Wilmington, where Dino had studios, and we did a lot of night shoots. And night shoots tend to bring people together because there's really, you do feel very isolated, like you're a little island filming away. And so I had Brad Dourif and Jack Nance and Dennis, of course, and Dean Stockwell over in my trailer. I had the only coffee machine, the cappuccino machine, on set. So it was working 24/7 pretty much. So we had coffees and, we played cards and in the little trailer table, and I was looking around one day, I just said, God, I said, how did I get here? You know what I mean? It's like, I'm sitting among giants in terms of the acting world. And I'm here and I'm like, I'm one of the luckiest guys around. So, it was a lot of laughing. There are very, very intense scenes. And I think in order to find the way through that, you sort of have to also have the lighter side, the lightening of things. And David has a terrific sense of humor too. And he, when the set needed to be intense and focused and dangerous, it was that's what it was. And then the rest of the time, David is a very light spirit, you know what I mean? And he's able to, again, create an environment where people feel comfortable and are very much at ease.
So is there a specific time or a defining moment or even a turning point when you realize you're actually making part of David Lynch's troupe of actors?
I guess Blue Velvet. Possibly moving into Twin Peaks, but with Blue Velvet. He had handed me the script during the filming of Dune for me to read. And so that was the second film script I ever read. Dune was the first, Blue Velvet was the second. you couldn't get two more different, you know, pieces of material. But I immediately related to the story, to the journey, let's say, of the character, of the callow youth, of the young man home who sees something dangerous and then gets drawn into this world, particularly with the allure of this very, very enticing woman, Dorothy, played by Isabella. And at the same time, kind of the voice of the angel as Laura Dern, you know, beckoning from the other side, and how he was trying to, you know, try to work with these two different energies. And I got it. I understood it. I said, and it took quite a long time for us to finally get to the filming of that, but I never lost the excitement, I think, and the anticipation, and and just the belief in the story. And I hope that it would happen. It took a while, but we finally did. We were able to get to the filming of Blue Velvet. But it was not, it was a little bit of a bumpy road to get there.
Is it true you showed the script to your mom and dad?
I did, yeah. They were, I've always been like that. I always wondered, I mean, currently I have a wine project, and then part of the reason that I did that was to involve my dad. So I showed it to my dad, I showed it to my mom. My dad was fine. My mom was, she was a little upset. So I paused for a minute. Truth be told, during that time, she was battling ovarian cancer. And so I didn't want to contribute to any kind of upset, didn't want to upset her or give her anxiety. So I just asked David to hold for a little bit. And finally I said, you know, she sort of said, okay. And I, you know, tried to, help her understand how it was going to be done and what it meant. Because when you read it, it's quite graphic. The script is quite graphic. And it's hard to imagine how David, with his care, was going to realize that, you know, as a director. So I kind of worked through that, and we were all ready to go. And we finally got to filming, I think, in the late summer of 85. I think it was 85, yeah.
That's because the film came out in 1986, so it must have been in 1985.
Yeah.
So Cannes Série is a TV series festival, but before we go through the many great shows you acted in, can we take a few seconds to talk about Showgirls, the highly controversial movie by director Paul Verhoeven? Critics were harsh when the film came out, yet it was quite well received here in France, and now it has a life of its own. You are Zachary, a Las Vegas show producer in the movie. You never played that type of character before, and I think you haven't since. Was it all about taking risks and doing something different from the clean-cut image you had at that time?
That was a big part of it, Claire. It were a combination of factors that I was interested in. One was it was a studio film. To that point, I mean, I'd done the Doors, but it was, you know, I was hidden behind wigs and makeup, but it was a studio film. I was very impressed with Paul Verhoeven as a director. He had done some of my favorite films. RoboCop is one that I absolutely adore. Of course, Basic Instinct as well. Some of his early work, Soldier of Orange Sweaters, from when he was working in Europe. So I had tremendous respect for him as a filmmaker. Joe Esterhaus at the time, who was the writer, had done some extraordinary film scripts. And this was a very highly charged, very controversial, very edgy story. And the character of Zach Carey, as you pointed out, was something I had not had the chance to do. And I think at that particular time and at that age, I was looking for something, a way to maybe break away a little bit from more of a clean cut image, or maybe more of a quirky image, to find something a little more dangerous and a little edgier. And I thought, oh, this could be, you know, this is really going to be impactful, which it was in an unexpected way. So I found myself in this world, in this situation. And to be honest, I had a wonderful time filming. I loved working with Elizabeth.
Who's a great actress. You know,
yeah, she did a wonderful job. I mean, it was, you know, she was, it was challenging, you know, because the film is so over the top. And my tendency on things is to sort of play under a little bit. And I think Paul expected her to kind of swing for the fences, so to speak, which she did. And oftentimes that can, you know, it just, sometimes it doesn't work. You know, the filming process was very regular. You know, I came in to shoot my scenes and did my work, and I watched some of the production that they were doing, and I said, this looks great. You know, I think it looks like a Vegas show. Not that I have much experience with Vegas shows, but it looked like one to me. And I just went about and did it. And I don't think, it wasn't until I actually saw the first screening, which they did privately for a couple of members of the cast, that I recognized how it had gone off the rails. And I was very surprised. I didn't expect that at all. And I said, oh boy, that wasn't exactly what I signed up for.
But the film features another key element of your cinematography. Although we'd already had a glimpse in Blue Velvet, can you guess what it is?
My chin?
Do you want to have a look?
Okay.
Do you like that?
Yes.
Don't touch me or I'll kill you.
So your derriere gained a status of its own around that time. How did that happen?
You know, it's funny. In Blue Velvet, you know, I as an actor that you are going to be in some delicate situations, I guess. And, you know, you are like, there's really kind of, you're just like, okay, you just sort of have to, for me, it's sort of, you're stepping into another place, you know, and you're kind of exposed. You're like, all right, this is what we're going to do. And you try not to think too much about it and just get through the scene and then get the robe on as fast as possible. You'll sort of notice as I'm walking across the pool in Showgirls, the last few feet, I'm kind of speeding up. I can't wait to get into that pool. So I'm not that comfortable walking around in the all together. And, you know, in the show, Sex and the City, you know, everybody at some point in time had to sort of be, you know, in the all together. But they don't give you a choice. The as an actor, the writers deliver a script to you. And I didn't know that was coming, you know, before, good choice of words. I didn't know that was going to happen before we got to that episode.
Especially in Sex and the City, it's really great fun. Those scenes are hilarious.
Yeah. And you, in some place in the back of your mind, you sort of rationalize it by saying, well, when I'm 60 or 70 years old, it's going to be nice to know what I look like as a younger man. And everything was in its right place.
Another of our special guests has a question for you regarding Showgirls and your following career.
Okay.
Hey, Kyle, as you know, Showgirls is one of my favorite films of all time. So I'm wondering, what advice would Zach from Showgirls give to Trey McDougal if you ran into him at the blackjack table in Las Vegas?
Zach would say, have another drink. And don't mess with my girls. How lovely to see Darren Star. He's become a friend, a very good friend. In fact, we had dinner just the other night together. And just a wonderful writer, wonderful storyteller. Yeah. So good at having his fingers on the pulse of what's happening with people and relationships and that dynamic. And, you know, I guess the idea of particularly his most recent, Emily in Paris, which he filmed in Paris, was someone who's thrown into a situation and they're sort of a fish out of water and trying to figure out how to navigate a completely different environment, which I think, I mean, he's just the best at that, I think.
From the early 2000s, you joined the cast of two TV series that had a major impact on their era, especially on female viewers. In Sex and the City, you were Trey MacDougall, Charlotte York's husband. Yeah. And then 10 years later, you became Bree's spouse, Orson Hodge. To me, Orson and Trey represent two different visions of husbandness. Yeah. What led you to play these almost perfect, but also very deviant characters?
When the creators of shows that are so good as those shows were, and the creators are incredibly talented, Darren Star and Michael Patrick King, of course, and on Sex and the City, and Mark Cherry on Desperate Housewives, you know, when they inquire after you and if you would be interested in joining the show that they've created, it's flattering, you know. I also thought that the writing on both shows was very good. They happen to also be shows that were popular at the time, and that's always nice to have something that's going, as opposed to trying to create something from scratch that you don't really know if the chemistry is going to be right or not for a pilot or a show like that. So these were ongoing shows. And I felt like I could contribute something to both of them. But I didn't really know kind of what they had in store for the Trey character, other than he was going to have some impotency issues. And there was a thing with his mom. And as we got into the story, I think it expanded more. And we were able to, I think, make more of a well-rounded character. But I love that. And I loved working at the time in New York City. It was early 2000s. I just met my wife, who was Desiree, who has become my wife. And so I was able to be in the city where she lived, and we were able to get together and be together more as I was working, and I thought that was wonderful. As far as the show goes, I loved working with Marcia Cross. Marcia Cross is also a graduate of a theater school, you know, kind of not unlike mine, a very good one. She's a Juilliard girl, and she was just so skillful. And when the dialogue between the two of us, when we were in the early stages, was really cracking along, and we had some funny stuff. It was really, there's nothing like that as an actor to work with someone like that, just a two-hand scene and have it just pop back and forth. It was really a pleasure.
You stayed in Housewives for almost six seasons. You actually acted in 96 episodes, which is a major commitment considering that you got abused by almost the female characters of the show, whether it was your mother or your yes. ex-wife or your wife or your mistress. So I can't yes. help thinking, are you somehow a masochistic?
You know, I think the character, when you're around that long, and I don't think that they anticipated that Orson would stay that long on the show. I think he was meant to be there for one season. Originally, from what I understand, and he was going to be the killer of Alma, and everything was going to resolve that. And I went to Mark Cherry early on in that first season, and I said, "Mark, I'm having such a great time here. I really enjoy this. Is there any chance that you would consider keeping me on past this season?" And he said, "Let me think about it." And they came up with the idea of having my mother come and be the actual killer, and having that dynamic go on. And I thought it was actually quite kind of brilliant in a way.
It's a fantastic idea. It's a
great storyline. And that wasn't me. They came up with that as a way to sort of keep me around. And I think it worked out very well and allowed me to continue on the show. Now they had to figure out what to do with me. And I think that's where we got into a little bit of trouble, just in terms of what was Orson there for, you know? So we moved through a number of different, you know, ups and downs in our relationship with Bree, with Marsh, with Bree Hodge, you know, and I don't know if we ever really found what he was meant to do after that, but I sure had a really lovely time just kind of hanging out and being on the show.
You wouldn't.
Stop it, Bree. Stop it. Stop it, Bree.
Only there was a word you could use to get me to stop, like...
Calling Joyce,
safety.
Go to hell.
Why can't you just see it? It's easy. Please. 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 Please.
Stop. Please. Stop it. Please. Stop. Please roll me over. Please help me off the toilet. Please. Please. Please.
What are you thinking?
I'm thinking I've never seen my John Thomas so hard. I swear, Charlotte, at times I felt like it was gonna rocket right off.
It's time! I'm ovulating! So get out of the tub! Get into this bed! Make love to me right now!
Charlotte, I was just telling Trey how much you remind me of myself at your age.
Tu me manques, Monique.
You embrace these roles with a lot of humor and wit. In fact, you are a comedy master. Where does that come from? And who are your comedy heroes?
Oh, thank you. I love humor. I love it in an unexpected way. I think early on, I was very much a big fan of Monty Python and that kind of non sequitur, unexpected, unusual, kind of out of the blue sense of comedy. But I also loved, grew up with the Carol Burnett Show and loved her comedy, Tim Conway and Harvey Korman together as a team. Gene Wilder is someone who I think is unbelievable, particularly in Blazing Saddles. And you know, everything he does, even Willy Wonka, he's just so subtle and so embracing of it and creates the character. You know, I think that's maybe the thing about, particularly about Gene Wilder, is like he was the character, and then out of the character came the comedy. And not that I'm really even aware of those things, but they all have an impact on me, I think, in some way. And they somehow kind of flows out of me, I guess. I think you have to recognize the comedy, but then you have to be absolutely serious in the playing of it.
The other thing that strikes me when I watch these scenes is how connected you are to your female partners, whether it's Kristen Davis or Marcia Cross or Sherilyn Fenn in Twin Peaks. You're really like a dynamic duo. So is it like for you as an actor, it always takes two to tango?
Yes, I think that comes from my theater training, where you rely real heavily on your scene partner. And that was always something that was stressed in the years of my training. And I think something very, very important, if you're really paying attention and connecting to your partner, the scene will be different every time because you'll be thinking of different things and they will be thinking of different things, and suddenly the scene will transform into something else. It'll be subtle, but it'll definitely be different. It's one of the great pleasures of working with those three women in particular, is just, you know, you allow these things to happen. And that comes right from the theater training.
Can we rewind to Blue Velvet for just a few seconds? Because one of the greatest examples of that work relationship to me is this absolutely magical scene we picked two clips from.
Are you the one that found the ear?
How did you know?
I just know, that's all.
I used to know a kid lived there, had the biggest tongue in the world.
What happened to him?
I don't know. I moved away. All my old friends are gone. You know the chicken walk?
Mm-hmm. Sam. That's kind of interesting.
So Tidbit is here with us tonight, and she has a question for you.
Hello, Kyle MacLachlan. I am so excited everyone here gets to have this experience of a masterclass with you. I'm privileged to say that I have spent my adult lifetime thus far acting with you and calling you my family. And of all the stories I love hearing you share, I wonder if you share with the audience our collective memory of the night of the chicken walk on Blue Velvet. It will be maybe my favorite night of filming in my life. Great mystery and beautiful memories. Sending so much love.
What a generous, gracious, extraordinarily talented woman. Laura Dern is very special. We met with David at Bob's Big Boy in Los Angeles, in the Valley. And David wanted to see the chemistry. And it was immediate and palpable. But it wasn't until we got to filming and the scene that we just saw that the chemistry, for lack of a better word, just bubbled up. And Laura is such a talented actress, and I think is also a big believer in the concept that it takes two, and that you are talking and listening. It's a simple phrase, and we use it on stage all the time, but talking and listening, simply reacting and letting those moments happen naturally. And David Lynch loves those moments. That he lives for those, the reality, the time taken, the look, the gesture. I was noticing even in this one, after I finished doing the chicken walk and I come back and I put my hand up for a moment on her shoulder and then I take it down again because there's a familiarity there, but we're not there yet. And that Jeffrey, it has a very kind of a gentlemanly kind of move, you know, and unexpected. And those kind of things just happen when you're working with Laura Dern. And I'm sure that there's many, many other actors who work with her and other things that she's done that would say exactly the same thing. Those things happen because of Laura Dern. The chicken walk was something that I had shared with David just on the set, you know, walking around doing something. And he said, or maybe I don't know if I suggested it or he said, why don't you do the chicken walk here? I said, hey, David, I want to try something or whatever it was. And it was something that I actually had been showed to me by a friend of my family when I was much younger, just as a goofy way to sort of, believe it or not, to walk around the golf course and do something kind of funny. So it came from a completely different place. And, you know, it's like life. You take these little pieces of things and you use them. You remember them and you use them in this creative process. And that's where that came from. So Denny Colvin is to be blamed for that. But it was a kind of a beautiful, unexpected, kooky moment that was also charming, and also Laura found, as the character of Sandy, found charming and probably sort of strange but interesting. So but it was a magical night, the way David created the scene where she comes out of the darkness like that. Which is classic David, you know. And you have this beautiful woman walking out and so approachable and so open and vulnerable. And it was just a beautiful moment.
About this chemistry you have with your female partners, there's no exception to that in Atlantic Crossing either. There is indeed a great connection between you and your co-star, the great Swedish actress, Sofia Helen. So Atlantic Crossing is part of Canceri's official selection. In this TV series, you play the role of President Franklin Roosevelt, The action takes place in 1941, right before the United States enters the war against Germany. Few people know it, but President Roosevelt did have an affair, or at least a romance, with Princess Martha of Norway after she sought asylum in the US with her children. This is, I guess, your first historical drama. You didn't try to look like Roosevelt, to me at least. Yet he's a non-fictional character. How challenging was this role to you, considering that Roosevelt was also an infirm, and so you're stuck in a wheelchair for like most of the show?
It was very challenging. Thank goodness for our for the lovely Sophia, as you said. She was unbelievable, and as you said, an extraordinary actress. Very intuitive, very available, very emotionally available, and very connected. And Alex, our director, also really interested in getting the human part of the story, and what their relationship was. You know, it's never, we really have no official word of the nature of their relationship. So we said they certainly had a very strong emotional connection. Whether it drifted into something else, we sort of dance around a little bit and maybe, you know, push here and push there. But they were trying to show great respect to the Norwegian royal family. The role for me was, as you said, we didn't go to great lengths to try to prosthetically turn me into Roosevelt. You know, we did a little bit with the hair. I think I might have worn a little bit of something that changed the shape of my mouth a little bit, which I'd actually used in Twin Peaks, funny enough. and then I had some wonderful, terrific gentlemen in New York that created some blue contacts that, while they weren't bright blue, they gave sort of a little bit of a movement there. Very difficult to try to get a bright blue contact on a dark eye, you know? So it was very subtle, but enough there that I think it you know, sort of resonates. So that, and then the challenge of trying to form the physical part of my body, you know, the legs, into making sure that, believing that these are actually spindly legs, as he had. The actual contraption that Roosevelt used was something he developed, in fact. And it was a way for him to be able to stand upright, not for very long, and a way for him to actually walk with the help of someone else, to give the illusion of the fact that he was that he could stand up and that he could appear to people in a presidential way. I also had like a big sort of fat suit that I got to wear. That was great. That meant I could go out to dinner, and because we were filming in Prague and I didn't have to worry about my diet so much. that was an upside, because the food in Prague was extraordinary. But it was, it was incredibly challenging on a number of levels.
Did you know the story when you read the script?
I did not. I did not know the story. There were some things that really surprised. First of all, the indomitable spirit of the Norwegian royal family was unbelievable, and the strength of will that the people had to survive and to not give in, you know, and to fight through this very difficult period of time in the world's history. That was one thing. I was also intrigued to know in my research what a struggle it was for Roosevelt to get the American people to buy into the idea of going to war. They had it with World War I. They did not want to get involved with Europe's problems. They didn't care. I think they recognized there were problems, but they were like, we're done. And he fought very hard, not just him, but others as well, to turn the tide, as it were, to people accepting the idea of going to war. And in fact, it wasn't until Japan attacked Pearl Harbor that and war was declared against Japan, Hitler then declared war against the United States. And in return, the United States declared war against Germany and Hitler. And it, so I was like, oh, I thought that America declared war on Germany and that was it. But it didn't happen until it happened in a different sequence. Mm-hmm. So you realize even then there was resistance. So this, all this is, was really wonderful research for me. I don't think I paid much attention when I was in school to this kind of history, but of course now as I'm older and as I'm working at Thatcher, it became fascinating. So I really dug into it. It was wonderful.
Do you think parallels can be drawn between that period of American history and the current situation in your country right now?
Well, no doubt we're in a difficult situation all over the world. And I think what we had in Roosevelt was a leader who recognized what his place was and what was expected of him. And he rose to the occasion and he inspired people. And he was the person that you looked to and recognized as a leader who was going to accomplish the things that needed to be accomplished. And I think right now we're struggling with that, having a leader who can really lead in that way, inspirational, asking people to do more than they think they can do, providing some light and some hope to people. That's really all they need, is just someone to feel like, hey, you're in my corner. And I think Roosevelt was really good at doing that. In fact, he, in some ways, I say he was the first social media president because of the way he used these things called fireside chats, where he would go on the radio and it was beamed directly into people's homes on the radio. So he had kind of personal connection to all of the families across the United States through the use of radio. And it's not unlike going on the internet and being able to broadcast.
What has the current situation changed for you as an actor?
Well, it's gotten very quiet. there is not a lot of activity in the film, television, and certainly none in the theatrical business right now.
Apparently, it gave you the opportunity to embark on another kind of fictional journey. We'll have a clip that's from your Twitter account.
What? Oh, didn't I have such big plans for us? At least I have this one. I will avenge you. This isn't over.
I want to see more. I mean, how many people work with you on those clips?
Well, I have a gentleman who's working as my assistant who does the filming on a little iPhone, and together we kind of come up with the idea and then we edit it. And then I have a team of people who work on my social media with me, and we send them the footage. And then for TikTok, of course, you lay in the music, and that's pretty much it. It's a very, we're extremely low budget. It's definitely, this is kind of where I live in terms of how my mind works, and creating some sort of fantastical situation, making it as believable as possible, and then working on the real specific timing of it so that it's funny and unexpected.
Thank you.
When Twin Peaks came out in 1990, TV shows at the time were considered to be a cheap, lesser art form. Lynch turned it into something funny, sexy, and catchy, a kind of giant playground with infinite possibilities for directors and producers. In that sense, do you see David Lynch as a visionary?
I do. David is an artist in every sense of the word. And he doesn't restrict himself to a certain medium. So at any given day, he'll be creating music. He'll be editing a puppet show. He'll be working in clay. He'll be drawing, painting. It's endless. And he's doing something every day. He's doing something creative every day. He's an inspiration to me, in fact. So I think he looked at television, and we haven't really had this conversation, but I think he looked at television as another medium, another place to play. And I don't think he put a judgment on it in terms of, oh, this means I'm working in a lesser art form. I think he saw it as, he saw what the potential was. And he kind of led the way. Well, he did lead the way. As a director of that stature, he suddenly, I think everyone looked around and said, geez, well, if David's doing it and doing it so well and creating something so interesting, my turn, you know? And to be honest, I think some of my work later on, and we can point to Sex and the City and Desperate Housewives, came because those creators, Darren Starr, Michael Patrick King, Mark Cherry, were aware and fans of Twin Peaks and recognized the potential. And they were like, hey, we're going to get into this medium. And that's how those shows were created. And then they were like, oh, well, let's bring Kyle in because he was kind of in the original. Why not have him too? So I think, definitely he led the way. I don't think any of the cast had an inkling of what was to come. I know we all signed contracts for 5.5 years, which you do, which is standard in the television business. But I think we all expected it to be kind of a 2-hour movie that would air whatever night of the week on ABC, and then we'd be done with it. So we did the pilot, and kind of everyone went on their separate ways and their journeys and stuff. And then, of course, ABC, it went through a whole channel and series of creative ups and downs, and was finally given the nod to go forward. And they chose to make 7 more episodes of that. So,
how did you develop Cooper's character, and how did you manage to make him real for about 30 years?
Oof. So much of the character was on the page of the script. And really just required me to breathe life into him and create this believable man. I was helped tremendously by the fact that it was David who directed the pilot. So we together created the original character of Dale Cooper. And then in the 30 years later, we worked very, very hard to create not only the Dale Cooper character, but the Mr. C character and the Dougie character as well. Yeah, so these were all really the two of us really working together and bringing these characters to life. And I, you know, somehow David and I just have a shorthand, you know. And whenever I jump in, I've always been very close to, I think, what he imagines the character to be. So I'm right there with him. I'm right in step with him. And, you know, bring these ideas and these thoughts about how these characters should live and breathe and move. And we, you know, together we sort of fine tune them. But so much of it is already, it's already there. It's already written. The blueprint is there.
Harry, Albert and his team are cream of the crop. Albert's a forensics genius.
If they're working for you, I wouldn't expect anything less.
But I gotta warn you, Albert's lacking in some of the social niceties.
Nobody's perfect.
Isn't that the truth?
All right.
No, That's not Dr. Lydecker.
Does Dr. Lydecker treat birds?
Why, yes, of course. Greta.
You know, there are plenty of other deaths in Twin Peaks.
Yes, but only one has a best friend with one arm. Harry? In the heat of the investigative pursuit, the shortest distance between two points is not necessarily a straight line.
So how much space did you have to improvise on set? Because David Lynch is really well known for his precision. So
Yes. And yet he's also very open to what he calls the happy accident, which he's spoken about, of which there were many, as you can imagine, during filming. And
yes, because I guess the llama didn't go to drama school, did he?
Did not go to drama school, and for some reason decided to stop in that moment. And the challenge, of course, was to just stay in character and to keep going forward, because it was such a great moment. I think there was a part of me in that particular instance that recognized, oh, this could really be funny if we don't drop out of character. And so I just stayed in it, and Mike Onkin, who played Sheriff Truman, stayed in it. And we got this kind of beautiful little unexpected moment. The little nose tweak, to be honest, I can't remember if David suggested that or if it just sort of happened by accident. It's a classic, I feel like it's a classic David moment. You know, this is something that he would just get a big kick out of, because it's endearing, it's funny, it's unexpected, it's met with no malice. It's just sort of like, oh, there's a chance here to do something kind of funny, and he does it and quirky, and then we move on with the scene. And so it felt quite comfortable, quite normal in that moment. All along the way, there were little bits and pieces that that would filter down, because again, it's you're trying to capture the quirkiness of life.
And Twin Peaks is also a giant jigsaw or maze. And as an actor, how did you find your way through it? Not so much the many storylines of the show, but mainly its grand design.
You know, I just left that to David, to be honest. I know with season three, I guess, the return, you know, there was a huge arc of storytelling there, and I played a number of different characters. And I just said, you know, I'm going to let David think about kind of the beginning, the middle, and end. And I'm just going to concentrate on the pieces that I'm doing that day. That, you know, I obviously had to think in terms of if there was carryover from scenes and where I was at any given moment. But by and large, just in terms of the understanding the story, I let David take care of that, and just kind of kept to my work.
Which leads us to Twin Peaks: The Return. In Twin Peaks: The Return, Laura Dern shows. In Twin Peaks: The Return, Laura Dern shows as your longtime assistant, Diane, a character that remained unseen in the previous seasons and Fire Walk With Me. Talking about Laura Dern, I think David Lynch has another question for you regarding this new season.
And the second question is, that could result in a story. It involves Laura Dern and the fact that you two were together after Blue Velvet, and then Twin Peaks came along, and Laura visited the set up in Washington, and there was a breakup. And it was not really a pleasant breakup, maybe. And then 25 years went by, and you didn't see Laura hardly at all. And then one day, Laura Dern was cast in the last 18 episodes of Twin Peaks, playing Diane. And the first day she came on the set, what happened? That's a question. And how are things with you and Laura Dern now?
That is the beauty of David. Indeed, Laura and I were together after Blue Velvet. We did have a breakup during Twin Peaks. We didn't see much of each other until we got closer to the filming of Twin Peaks. When I heard that she was cast as Diane, I thought it was absolutely perfect, genius. No one else could do that. And so I was very pleased that she was going to be back and part of the team. We had spoken before and cleared everything up and everything was okay. But the first day that she was back filming, she didn't want to see me before we went to the scene. And I said that would be fine. And the intention, of course, was to capture whatever the emotions that were going to happen, because we hadn't seen each other for a while. The character of Mr. C, just to sort of tangent a little bit, was very challenging for me because as an actor, I pride myself, or I guess, I don't pride myself, but I guess one of the things I strive for is the connection with the other actor, the other performer, to really connect with them in whatever fashion, but to have some kind of a connection. And the character of Mr. C is not about connecting at all. He is completely separate.
Sociopath,
disengaged completely. Although he may pretend to try to connect, which he does in that scene, he's not. So here I am working on a scene with two people I love very much and having to show no sign of that love or connection or care. And it was one of the most difficult scenes in the show for me to do, simply because I was working again with people that I cared so much about. And it was very challenging to say that. Laura and I have, as I said, cleared everything. We're great friends. I love her to death. And David has, I think, secretly always hoped that we would be able to become friends over the years, which we always were, but our friendship deepened. But he was there when we met, and he was there when we reconnected. And I think that was kind of a special time for him. Another special time happened when he was given the Academy Award, Special Academy Award. And I don't know whether you're going to speak about that, but I remember being able to work with Laura to present to him, Isabella also there to present to him. And these are really, really important people in his life. And afterwards, we went backstage and outside to sit at a little table and just share the moment, the four of us. And we took like a half hour, we just kind of disappeared. And we took like a half hour and just sat and laughed and cried and told stories. And it was one of the most amazing times that I've had with David. Very surprising in a moment like that where I don't expect that, but you're honoring someone who you love and care about so deeply for so many years. And you see them and you're standing on stage with someone who you care a great deal about with Laura. And it just sort of comes up out of nowhere unexpectedly. That was a very magical night.
You mentioned that Mr. C was a very difficult character for you to play, but I think Dougie was also a very challenging character. Yes. And I was wondering why, for what particular reasons was it so hard to play for you?
There was the logic of the character. So he's a bit of a puzzle in knowing what he's experienced before, what he hasn't experienced before, what his reaction to something new is. How does he learn? How does he learn about coffee? You know, it's a smell and then it's a thing. And he sort of gradually builds on the knowledge of what this wonderful elixir is that he drinks. So there was that part. And then there was the emotional part, which was challenging as well, because in my thoughts, he has all the emotions that are in there, or at least he has very confused emotions, but he just doesn't know what they are, if that makes sense. So he doesn't know what's happening to him, but he knows he feels something, you know, whether it's sadness or sexual awareness or, empathy or joy. So it became about how is that revealed? And it was very challenging. I loved working with Naomi Watts. I thought she was perfectly cast as Janie E. And she just made that character believable. And that was a challenging thing to do, that she would buy Dougie and who he was, and she accepted what he was, and just kind of just moved through life like a tornado, you know? And she made a lot of the Dougie-ness possible, to be honest.
Dougie. Do you find me attractive? Well, do you? I find you attractive.
I had to dig into some courage there to really believe that the amount of time I was taking to discover something or learn something was okay. And that was really due to David. David allowed me that time because I would sometimes feel the pressure of, oh, I got to get through this because it's just not going to sustain. But he helped me believe that it would sustain, and he was right.
David Lynch transcends time and death with this new season. What's the greatest thing you've learned from him? And what do you think is the greatest thing he's learned from you?
Oh. Well, I mentioned a little earlier that he is an artist in true sense of the word, creates in every medium that interests him. But I admire him because of his adherence to his vision. I've never seen him question his creative process. I've seen him wrestle with it. I've seen him sometimes search for the right way, but I've never seen him doubt it. I guess that's a better word. Doubt that what he feels, what he sees, what he thinks is not of value. And I just have a tremendous admiration for that. I wish I were more like that. I wish I could be more like that. He's created this foundation, the David Lynch Foundation. He really believes in transcendental meditation as a way to help people to make their lives better. And he's been a meditator for certainly as long as I've known him and longer. And he really believes in the transformative process. And I admire that about him too. Never seems to doubt it, never doubts it. Absolute belief. These are qualities in him that I think are incredibly special. And when you add to that a person who is capable of so much love, so much empathy, so much care, so much grace that he allows the people around him. He's allowed me to misbehave, go off the rails, and never stop loving me. And that is, I don't know how he does it, to be honest. And I think he's probably learned from me to be patient, to be patient with me. I hope he values, I know he values our friendship. And I think he, I don't know. I don't know what he could have learned from me. I mean, I think just, I'm really lucky and grateful that I know him and that I can call him my friend and he can call me his friend and we have a love for each other. So.
Beautiful. And this will be my last question. Even though you've worked with many other directors, you are best known as David Lynch's favorite actor. You are his messenger too, which gives you this very unique status in cinema, yet you remain a mystery for many people, many viewers around the world. Who are you really, Kyle MacLachlan?
I'm just a kid from Yakima. I am still, I guess, figuring that out. You know, I think of myself as a husband, as a father, as an actor, winery owner, you know, and these are sort of labels of what I am and who I do. But I hope it's more about maybe an example of trying to be a kind person, trying to be an understanding person, trying to be an empathic person. I think as an actor, these are necessary qualities in order to really dig into a character and understand the character, where they're coming from, what they're all about. Those qualities, which when I was younger, I don't think I gave much value to, and maybe tried to disregard, I realized that actually they're really important. And I think they are qualities that I'm trying to, not that I need to instill them in my son because he already has them, but to allow him to understand that these are qualities that are of value and not to be taken lightly or disregarded, or, you know, they can be exposing, but they are definitely worthwhile.
Thank you so much. I'm so grateful. Thank you.
Claire, it's a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for your insightful questions or interesting questions. I guess thank you for showing my behind three times. We can remember.
That was a special treat, you know.
Yeah, you go. Well, I've enjoyed our time together too. Much appreciation. Thank you for taking the time.
it you? Is it really you?
Yes. It's really me, Diane.
Merci à toutes et à tous d'avoir suivi cette séance sur Cannes Série Live. N'oubliez pas que vous pouvez retrouver sur la plateforme chaque jour de nouveaux rendez-vous et de nouvelles séries. Très bon festival et à bientôt.